It's a great honor to be part of this historical and at the same historic conference, really. It's the first of this kind this year. And this year is a jubilee year. Incidentally, in February 1917, as we all remember, there was a February bourgeois, the so-called bourgeois February Revolution. And then October, socialist, great Soviet socialist revolution was also took also place. Strange as it may seem, but the great October, as it was called, socialist revolution in Russia, brought tremendous changes to the former empire, really. And in fact, it contributed to the Ukrainian National Revolution in a way, and the creation of Ukrainian National People's Republic in 1917. At the same time, the 7th of November, which was the greatest holiday in the Soviet Union, is not only remembered, marked, or celebrated, it is simply ignored, as many other revolutions are ignored by the current Russian leadership, specifically by President Putin. In fact, the first colored revolution that happened in that area, I think, was the events in August 1991, when the Soviet, the communist regime fell in Russia. In contrast, Ukraine is and will be widely celebrating the event of the Ukrainian National Revolution and the creation of Ukrainian People's Republic. Before going on, let me introduce myself. My name is Valeriy Kuchynskyi. I'm a former Ukrainian diplomat. My last assignment was at the United Nations as Ukraine's permanent representative. And after terminating my tenure as Ukraine's ambassador, I switched to academia. And since 2007, I've been teaching at Columbia University, mostly topics dealing with Ukraine, Ukraine's foreign and domestic policies, and Ukraine's participation in international organizations, specifically the United Nations. Our today's panel will continue to deal with many issues, and specifically with cultural renaissance in the country brought about by the Ukrainian National Revolution. The short but very turbulent period of the existence of the Ukrainian People's Republic was marked not only by outstanding political and diplomatic activities, but also by an upsurge in cultural, educational, religious, artistic developments. The leaders of Ukrainian spirituality and artistic geniuses, some of whom were discussed yesterday, Krimsky, Efremov, Yuri Mezhenko, many others, which for obvious reasons could not be discussed during a short period of time, like Les Kurbas, Mikhail Boychuk, Vladimir Vinichenko, Mikhail Semenko, Vasil and Fedor Krichevsky, David Burluk, Alexander Arhipenko, Kazimir Malevich, Alexander Mareshka, and many, many others. The list, of course, is very long, and we don't have time to go on. But all of these made a considerable contribution to world culture. Even after the defeat of the Ukrainian Revolution, the flourishing of Ukrainian culture, literature, and arts continued for some time. In fact, till the end of the 1920s, then, as we all remember and as we all know, it was crushed by Joseph Stalin and his butchers. Today's attempts by a well-known power to steal some names and misappropriate their achievements and put the other names into oblivion are doomed to failure and should be vigorously rebuffed. So today we have a treat for everyone here. We'll talk about Heorhii Narbut, the most important Ukrainian graphic designer of the 20th century, painter, illustrator, teacher. All his creative endeavors and his tremendous creative outcome included everything, numerous illustrations in books, publishing books and in magazines, specifically the Ukrainian alphabet, a book which was not unfortunately finished, the designing of the coat of arms of Ukraine at the time, banknotes, postage stamps, and all of his creative endeavor had one common feature, the presence of Ukrainian national identity and of Ukrainian heritage. We'll talk also about today about Kyrylo Stetsenko, another Ukrainian genius, a prolific composer, conductor, critic, and teacher. Late in his life, he became a Ukrainian Orthodox priest and head of the music department of the Ministry of Education in the short-lived Ukrainian People's Republic. We'll have a chance to hear some of his art songs today during the concert at the Ukrainian Institute of America. And without further ado, with your permission, I'll introduce the first speaker, Professor Myroslava Mudrak. She's Emerita Professor of History of Art at The Ohio State University. Her teaching centered on modernist art of the late 19th and early 20th century, with special emphasis on avant-garde and abstract art in Europe. Professor Mudrak continues to focus on the unfolding of modernism in Eastern Europe and the former Soviet Union and in Ukraine. Her primary interest is in the ideological discourses, socio-political influences, and artistic practice within East European cultures that use modernity to signify national identity. All the bios are available, so they are quite extensive, so you may read them during the break. But I'll stop on that and give the floor to Myroslava Mudrak. You have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. As anachronistic as it might appear, Heorhii Narbut's modernist aesthetic was shaped by the 18th century. The region surrounding the town of Hluchiv, where Narbut was born, once the seat of the Cossack Hetmanat, would have a great impact on the development of the Narbut style. Hluchiv, from whence also hailed two of the finest composers of the 18th century, Dmytro Bortnyansky and Maxim Berezovsky, could be described as a kind of time capsule, preserving a rich history of Ukrainian material culture from antiquity to the present, which easily inspired young creative minds such as Narbut's. As a young student, Narbut was turned onto his artistic path, surrounded by the imposing architecture of the classicizing era of Mazepa, typical of the region. By taking part in archaeological excavations in the region and being simultaneously exposed to the heraldry, insignia, and other accoutrements of Cossack nobility, this rich cache of artifacts could not but leave an indelible impression in shaping Narbut's future artistic path. To prepare for his vocation, Narbut would copy and commit to memory the linear forms found in old manuscripts from the Ostrich and Persop Bibles and Monomach's instructions to his children to newer publications of the Chanson de Roland. What appealed to him was the richly visual epistolary style that made the content of these books visually accessible. Through this scriptorial lens, the artist developed an aesthetic stamp fairly early in life, but would not establish his brand until he could filter his experience through established channels. Enchanted by the graphics medium, particularly the illustrational style of Ivan Bilibin, central member of the dandified Society of Literati and Painters in St. Petersburg, they called themselves Mir Iskustva, or the world of art, Narbut traveled to the capital in 1906 to become Bilibin's acolyte. St. Petersburg was at its cultural pinnacle in the 18th and 19th centuries. Beginning with Peter's westernization, which transformed the aristocracy into a French-speaking elite, through the Rococo aesthetics of the Tsar's daughter, Elizabeth, followed by the sobering classicizing tendencies of the Enlightenment cultivated by the Empress Catherine, St. Petersburg was the crucible of what could certainly be described as a modern culture in the otherwise insular backwardness of the Russian Empire at large. At first, Narbut's style was somewhat indistinguishable from Bilibin's influence, but soon the young artist surpassed his teacher by introducing the arsenal of visual tropes from the Cossack Baroque sources that formed his aesthetic sensibilities from the very beginning, which by the time of the revolution would be shaped into a distinctly Ukrainian mold. The abstracted ornamental motifs typical of Cossack furnishings, official documents, the colors of banners of Cossack regiments, and various other paraphernalia of Cossack lore set a different course for Narbut's development, even while he surrounded himself in the elegant finery of St. Petersburg's Pickwickians. The Mir Iskusniki revolted against the national consciousness-raising tendencies embraced by the Peredvizhniki and loathed their narratives of social transformation and descriptive focus on gritty peasant life. For this Petersburg set, the 18th century was a reference point for the pure aestheticization of Russian artistic culture. Their embrace of the Rococo and neoclassicism periods was purely a call to a more aesthetically cohesive world and a cultivation of art for its own sake. While Narbut most certainly appreciated the extravagant designs of Alexandre Benois, Konstantin Somov, and Leon Bakst, which leader Sergei Diaghilev, the head figure of the world of art and the impresario of the Ballet Russe, used as a rallying point for promoting Russian art in Paris, their revivalist ethos from paganistic Rus in a production of Prince Ihor, to French classicism in Le Pavillon d'Armide, two of Ballet Russe's performances of 1909. These would carry very different aesthetic connotations for Narbut. While St. Petersburg aestheticized the past in a sensationalist manner, for the Ukrainian, classicism would be transmogrified, as in Ivan Kotlarevsky's Eneida, as a case in point. This is not Eneida by Narbut. This is an example of the character of Mir Iskustva in St. Petersburg. And this is Narbut's work for Eneida. So classicism would be transmogrified, as in Ivan Kotlarevsky's Eneida, as a case in point, to transform the classic prototype into an inherently Ukrainian and fully contemporary subject. Narbut learned much from the refined, if somewhat artificial and eclectic imperial ambiance of St. Petersburg. But he translated the experience of this immersion into terms that tapped into Ukrainian cultural sensibilities. The exacting features of 18th century chinoiserie, embodied by the mellow combinations of ochre and yellow in Catherine's Oranienbaum Palace, for instance, and enhanced by the Rococo's supremely linear manner, as opposed to the painterly flourishes of the Baroque, appealed to Narbut's newfound delicacy and fineness of detailing as he continued to train himself as a graphic artist outside of Ukraine. I just want you to see one of his illustrations, and I'd ask you to note the parquet floor as a visual detail, because it represents a kind of dimensional play of black and white, which Narbut would later turn into a checkerboard motif, freely adopted to become a kind of signature trait of the artist's graphic work in Ukraine. To broaden Narbut's education, Bilibin and Mstislav Dobuzhinsky, two prominent World of Art members, encouraged their protege to go to Munich to study with the highly reputed Hungarian graphic artist Simon Holosi. Accompanied by Mohilevsky and with a letter of introduction from Somov, Narbut spent only a short time in Munich in 1909-1910 and never really linked up with Holosi, but took advantage of the artistic riches of the Alte and Neue Pinakothek, spending hours absorbing the art of Albert Dürer and coming to terms with a dramatic dark-like play of Félix Vallotton and the striking black and white art of Aubrey Beardsley. Measuring himself against these artists brought about a self-awareness in Narbut that marked an important advance in his artistic consciousness, made even more poignant by the cosmic event of Halley's Comet, which Narbut recorded in 1910. There was something ominous and understated about that instance of Narbut's rendering of the spectacular light of the comet against the dark skies. Observing it far from his homeland and far from the rarefied world of St. Petersburg, it must have registered as a portent of potential dread or possible redemption. Indeed, in this pivotal moment of Narbut's life, his tenuous rendering of the event, executed in watercolor, dwells on distinct contrasts. A refined classical structure illuminated by the light from above is seen on the right-hand side, while untamed nature in the shadows of darkness is visible on the left. The entire setting, as far as can be seen, is devoid of humanity. As the comet shoots through the night sky, it sheds its light on this binary landscape, privileging neither side. As wondrous and spectacular as the comet must have appeared, its neutralizing power, striking down hierarchies of all sorts, makes no distinction between a constructed environment and raw nature. Only with the outbreak of World War I and the collapse of the empires would the comet's symbolism come to fruition for Narbut. At this point, Narbut's art would take on an unprecedented vehemence, exploding with the full emotional Baroque fury as he responded in a series of powerful wartime allegories to the cataclysmic decimation of the empires. In these works, the once innocent comet is transformed into lightning rods. The calm rolling hills of the land erupt seismically, and classical structures, the traces of civilized humanity, collapse. All is set in a state of ruination by dissolving powers represented by their heraldic symbols. After his return from Munich to St. Petersburg, Narbut, now a fully formed graphic artist, worked prolifically producing illustrations for current publications. From the fables of Ivan Kyrylo to illustrating books on the Napoleonic era, celebrating the victory of 1812 over the French. In the former, he indulged himself in the fantastic and the fanciful, depicting dolls and animals, puppets and playhouses, animating the inanimate. In the latter, he becomes preoccupied with emblems of antiquity, broken obelisks, ruined classical columns, mottos, monograms, symbols, shields, and insignia. In the detailing of these items, Narbut's predilections for the historical come into active play. The specific militarized features of the Alexandrine Empire period style compelled him to render the ruins of the past as an embodiment of the present. He not only studied the objects of this period, but he surrounded himself with empire-style furniture and expressed himself sartorially by wearing anachronistic Arakcheyev dress, as you see here in a painting by Kustodiev. At the same time, reviving the black and white genre of the silhouette, Narbut addresses issues of anonymity and isolation, mostly a unidimensional realm ostentatiously outlining a world filled with beautiful things and fickle finery. Taking his cue from his fellow dandies, Narbut allowed himself to embody the fanciful world that easily transports one into escapist realms. Yet Narbut's Petersburgian period was a period of dualistic quests. Surrounded by a world of artifice, he is also awakened to the living past as emblematized by the heraldic arts, and he begins with full gusto to turn to things Ukrainian. Through his friendship with Vladimir Lukomsky and a circle of leading heraldists based in St. Petersburg, Narbut rekindled this passion and revived his own family crest containing three hunter's horns on a shield. At the same time, Narbut begins visiting the old gentrified sites of Chernihiv, Nizhyn, Poltava, and Hluhiv regions, touring 18th century country estates in these areas, taking note of the Alexandrine period architecture and Mazepinian Baroque, and establishing connections with his compatriots, lovers of Ukrainian antiquities, and genealogists seeking to preserve their own family crests, such as Petro Doroshenko, as you see here. It was during this time, just after the war, that he met historian Vadim Mozalevsky, architect and art historian, who had become the Minister of Preservation of Antiquities in the Chernihiv region and would be the future publisher of Nashe Minule, Our Past, with whom Narbut forged a fast friendship for many years to come until their untimely deaths in 1920. And I wanted to show you this because I think it demonstrates the bond between Mozalevsky, Zaitsev, the editors of Nashe Minule, and the moment that the first issue of Nashe Minule emerged. Narbut writes, Nareshti, finally, it's here. The 18th century proved to be a gold mine for manifesting Ukrainian identity, and Narbut championed this link and rekindled it as a pathway to Ukrainian artistic modernism. The revolution was critical to this evolution. Once in Ukraine, Narbut transformed the Petersburgian experience with all of its local attributes to a universalizing brand of a modern Ukrainian national art. He did this by bringing the sophisticated, robust lineage of the Cossacks into relief without artifice and fanfare, but quietly, elegantly, in a concise, clear template. Here one sees Narbut as a kind of cultural Janus figure, a reference to the Roman god of transitions and passages, simultaneously looking back and looking forward, keeping the past alive as he forges the future. Narbut's is not the first case of a successful Ukrainian artist broaching two cultures and two time periods, finding fame and career satisfaction in a foreign land, in Russia in particular. The existential tension created by this involvement in the interstices of two separate aesthetic spheres oftentimes resulted in compelling outcomes. Such was the case with Narbut's Petersburgian predecessor, the Ukrainian painter Dmytro Levitsky, who served the Russian court in the 18th century. While there is no direct link between Narbut and Levitsky per se, I would like to dwell briefly on what might be discerned as their position within the rarefied environment of Russian imperial culture. From the initial founding of the St. Petersburg Academy of Arts, Ukrainians had contributed greatly to its glory and reputation. As early as 1758, when the St. Petersburg Academy of Arts barely got off the ground, Kievan painter and engraver for the Kievan Cave Monastery Press, Dmytro Levitsky, was brought to the new capital, where over a span of a half a century, his style of painting shaped what has come to be known as a school of Russian portraiture, Russian imperial portraiture. Among Levitsky's widely circulated portraits, you will find that of architect Alexander Kokorinov, the designer of the St. Petersburg Academy. You'll also find young aristocratic ladies of the Imperial Educational Society for Noble Girls, the Smolny Institute or the Smolny Convent School, and a grand portrait of the Empress herself. Typical of Levitsky is the skill with which he treats fanciful dress and the qualities of their varied materials, from silk and taffeta to very fine lace. It is as if the textural qualities of these rich fabrics are brought to life and animated by the artist's hand, taking precedence over the tenuous visages of the young and rather awkward maidens. The visual tension between these contrasting elements, however, causes one to reflect back on the artist and question his intentions. Rather than dwell on a description of the personage depicted and render the subject in a manner that would flatter the sitter, the painter has chosen, and riskily at that, to take artistic license in offering the viewer an intimate glimpse into a courtly world that has gone somewhat awry. Not unlike what would be more famously achieved by Francisco Goya, and I just remind you of a famous painting here, of the court of Charles IV, which I'm not sure you all know, but Velázquez, the painter, did I say Goya? Goya, never mind, let's keep it at that. Not unlike what would be, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. Not unlike what would be more famously achieved by Francisco Goya in 1880 and his rather unflattering family court portrait of Spanish King Charles IV. This rather odd display of Levitsky's artistry comes across as an attempt to bring more attention to the shimmering materiality of metals and the sparkle of the insignia of rank that Catherine wears, rather than providing for the idealization of the role of the imperial figure. Painted several years earlier and in a court distant from Spain, Levitsky's rendering of Catherine accomplishes something rather extraordinary. First of all, he makes the rather homely figure of Catherine goddess-like. Her masculine Germanic features are softened to create a relaxed, gracious visage, and complimentary at that. Her posture is also elegant and graceful, despite her rather imposing girth. It is not so much the figure of Catherine that is important here, but rather the surrounding detail. Let us remember that Catherine had destroyed the Zaporizhian host less than a decade prior to the completion of this painting. The irony of Levitsky's position as a Ukrainian within the imperial court could not have gone unremarked by the painter. As the title reveals to us, Levitsky places the Empress, who paradoxically was dedicated to the ideals of enlightenment, in the temple of the goddess of justice, a classical figure. The figure is shown, the figure would be shown in sculptures of the antique world to be masked so as not to influence the final judgment in either direction, and she would hold up the scales of justice and equal balance. Here, we see quite the opposite. Justice's eyes see all. The scales are tipped, and a look and posture of exasperation engulf the stone form. The heraldic eagle, jealously ogling the book of the law, which incidentally you will find to be closed, turns back onto Catherine, who is paying homage to justice by throwing rose petals on the pyre, oblivious to the judgment she is receiving from the goddess of justice. Such parallels, well, they're not really parallels, but I bring this up as a kind of example of a potential parallel between Levitsky and Narbut, which operates on a philosophical level and helps to explain how Narbut could have been a fully contributing member of the world of art society and yet completely turn his attention to Ukrainian matters as soon as the empire came to an end. This dualism is revealed in part by Narbut's project of the Ukrainian alphabet, first taken up in St. Petersburg in 1917, but never completed. On each of the letter pages, one finds a summary of Narbut's hallmark style to date: Mazepinian architecture, Orientalist figures, classical ruins, dolls and puppets and playthings, tactile architectonic surfaces, skies illuminated by light, Cossacks and theater maquillage, all of it, including the scriptorial form of the letters, contained within the strictness of old Slavonic manuscripts. In this very same spirit, he designed the coat of arms, and I will get to that in a minute. Just let you enjoy the pages of the Ukrainian alphabet here, and soak in Narbut's style. And this is the coat of arms of the Ukrainian state. He would also create the new currency, postage stamps. This is still currency, playing cards, and other documents, including the insignia of the first ever Ukrainian Academy of Art, which was founded in 1917. I don't wish to tread on the subject of the academy that will be covered by my colleague Marko Stech, who will follow, but I would like to make a few remarks regarding Narbut's role in its founding, for it marked a critical shift in Narbut's life, serving to coalesce the branding features of his aesthetic, imbuing it with the quality of universal recognizability. As appointed head of the graphics division, Narbut created the original invitation for the auspicious event of the founding of the academy. Using ink in a freehand style, capturing the character of the old Ukrainian skoropis, the announcement is declarative and bold, giving the air of officialdom with a slight hint of the capriciousness of Narbut's own quirky and playful character. Despite the date listed, the Central Rada was delayed in its paperwork that would ratify the founding of the academy, and it remained uncertain until the last moment when the actual date of the opening of the academy would occur. When finally determined, the final version of Narbut's elegant design was rather inelegantly corrected when the date was finally decided. The event was marked by a grand exhibition dedicated to the work of its professors, held in the building of what became the Central Rada headquarters. I'm sure you know this building. If you've been to Kyiv, you know this building. And what I'm showing you on the bottom there is the ground plan for the building and the place where Narbut's exhibition took place within the halls of this building. And this is what Narbut contributed to this first exhibition, inaugural exhibition of the Academy of Art in Ukraine. And it is basically pages from his Ukrainian alphabet and also some of these ruins from the Empire period on display. Now I'd like to say a few things about Narbut's legacy. Narbut's lingering legacy is revealed in the work of at least two notable generations of Ukrainian artists. Rooted in his own historical sources, Narbut's style was based on laconic, emblematic form inspired by the stark, let's see what I have next, yes, by the stark clarity of black or red lettering on the yellowing grounds borrowed from old Slavonic printed matter. He practiced the disciplined interplay between word and image to achieve a precise, uncluttered, synoptic composition, oftentimes borrowing directly from classical sources. The fluidity of the Cyrillic alphabet, the curvature of its letters, and especially the supple embellishment of initials and accents in old manuscripts appealed to his visual sensibilities and easily carried over to the next generation. The first phase of Narbut's influence could be seen in the vast array of Ukrainian language publications that were issued during the Cultural Renaissance of the 1920s. Belonging to this first generation of Narbutians, prominent graphic artists such as Les Lozovsky, Robert Lisovsky, and a slew of others, and I'll just show you a few examples, are linked in a formalist way to the Narbut brand. A few more examples. They have fully absorbed Narbut's concise manner, his architectonic structures, and organic flourishes, making clear that they constitute a specific school of graphic design that was the stamp of Narbut. What is more remarkable, however, is the power of Narbut's influence on a more recent generation of artists who since the 1980s have comprised a Ukrainian new wave of contemporary and even we could call it postmodern art. Central to this group is the painter, graphic artist Oleg Tistol, who had been one of the first to be invited to the Moscow Squatters Group at Furmanny Lane in the late 1980s, when people first began to become interested in the contemporary art of the former Soviet Union. Despite the hospitality and kinship shown by Moscow artists, Tistol and his colleagues, feeling much like Levitsky and Narbut, artists in a foreign culture, would soon find their way back to Ukraine and emerge as a group called the Paris Commune. It was called that because their studios were located on Paris Street in Kyiv. It had nothing to do with revolution, but one could appreciate the irony there. Taking up projects that related directly to works created by Narbut and historical inspiration, as for example, and this is a project that Tistol worked on called Reunification of 1988, and the Ukrainian Money Project, which spanned a period from 1997 to 2010. I hope you can see that Tistol's art directly reflects upon the influence of Narbut. Using national and Soviet symbols, Tistol's art echoes the heraldic nature of Narbut's work and itself harkens back to the Cossack era of the 17th and 18th centuries and the founding of the modern Ukrainian state, but this time after a new independence from Soviet hegemony. Like Narbut, Tistol and other artists of this conceptual ilk, and I'm showing you even a younger artist, Mykola Matsenko, have not only absorbed the formal aspects of Narbut, but also the philosophical issues of inclusivity and exclusivity that underlay Narbut's art. For Narbut, it was the transition from the imperial to the post-imperial. For the conceptualists, Tistol and Matsenko, and others of the new generation of what has come to be called the neo-baroque, they engage with the post-Soviet abyss. Let me show you another work by Matsenko. And let me end with this image here as I make my concluding remarks. As a singular concept, branding is intimately associated with receptivity and a sense of association with what the brand represents. Certainly, aspects of Narbut's life as an artist were gauged at addressing his own sense of inclusion within his immediate circles, and achieving that inclusivity meant inserting himself into the company that allowed his creative energies to flow and to create an artistic medium and express themselves in an artistic medium that allowed his signature visual language to emerge. Identifying with the network of the Myriskousniki, which was by no means onerous for Narbut, went hand in hand with brandishing a certain sartorial taste and manner. He thus achieved success not only in feeling one with this community of artists, gratified and emboldened by their acceptance of him, but in reciprocity also indulging in their aesthetic fancies, adopting them for his own purposes. This rudimentary form of branding was primarily and initially associated with Narbut's artistic persona and manifested itself by the affect of his dress, his demeanor, and his social connections. Narbut's art, however, goes beyond the individual person to the creation of a more sweeping and imagistically weightier cultural brand that serves as a response to larger existential issues of inclusivity and exclusivity that can be applied to Ukrainian visual culture as a whole. While Narbut is still the artist who creates the second ascended level of cultural branding, it is his artwork as brand products unto themselves that define the values of cultural belonging while maintaining a national culture's distinctiveness. The reception of those values in postmodern contemporary Ukrainian art are central to the current generation of Oleg Kistol's circle. What contemporary Ukrainian artists grapple with today is the ease with which Narbut was able to effect a shift in attitude while remaining true to himself. It is for that reason that his art continues to have resonance today. Thank you very much.
So let me introduce our second speaker, who is Marko Stech, and he's Executive Director of Canadian Institute of Ukrainian Studies, Press, and Project Manager of the Internet Encyclopedia of Ukraine and the Grushevsky Translation Project at the Canadian Institute of Ukrainian Studies. He also teaches courses on Ukrainian cultural history at York University in Toronto. He holds a PhD in Slavic languages and literatures from the University of Toronto. He is a literary scholar specializing in 20th century Ukrainian literature, particularly in the cultural renaissance of the 1920s and the Ukrainian post-war emigre literature. You have the floor, Mr. Stech.
Thank you very much. When we think of a revolution, I would imagine that most of you, just like me, would have images of social upheaval, of massive, often violent social movements, of toppling of governments, of uprooting of certain established order. In general, especially in the first stages of the revolution, we would not think of establishing institutions as a revolutionary act of revolution, unless they are institutions of a certain type, the institutions that actually support the revolutionary struggle. If I think of the Bolshevik Revolution of the October-November 1917, and I think about the types of institutions that they did establish, on the one hand side, they are the local Soviets, which proved to be a fiction almost from the beginning because they had no power in general. But really, the two institutions that they did establish in my mind, I don't know if Mark will agree with me, is the Red Army and the Cheka. So the institutions that were responsible for conquering, for inducing terror, for destroying, expropriating, but not for creating. In that sense, a Ukrainian revolution proves to be very different. And I would like to argue that in the approach to the institution and to the lawmaking, the Ukraine revolution is almost the opposite of what the October Revolution in Russia was. And especially, I will talk about two examples of the Ukrainian State Academy of Arts and the Kyiv Conservatory, which remarkably not only were formed primarily during the revolutionary time, but which actually survived till today. They were not just a temporary revolutionary phantom organizations going through various, we yesterday talked about the continuity and going through various changes of governments, going to a few different sorts of reincarnations. These institutions both exist today and they are extremely important today. The National Academy of Arts and Architecture in Ukraine is a direct descendant of the Ukraine State Academy of Arts, and so is National Academy of Music of Ukraine, a direct descendant of the Kyiv Conservatory. I'll show you a few photographs. And I'll introduce the main authors. By the way, harking back to our discussion yesterday, there is Mikhailo Hrushevsky right there, head of the Central Rada government. Apart from him, you will see also another representative of the Central Rada government right next to Hrushevsky. This is Ivan Stetsenko, who is the the guy with a bow tie, Ivan Stetsenko, who is the Minister of Education. They are the two. These photographs, actually, this photograph was taken on the 22nd of November, 1917, the very changed date that was on the Narbut's invitation. And then you see the founding, almost all founding professors of the Academy of State Academy of Arts. And from the left, from the right, I'm sorry, they are Abram Manevich, Oleksandr Murashko, let me not make it, Fedya Kruchevsky, above him Narbut, Heorhii Narbut, then you have Hrushevsky and Stetsenko, you have Vasil Kruchevsky right above Hrushevsky, you have Mikhail Burchuk right next to him, and then you have Mykola Buracek on the left. There's a second photograph taken in exactly the same day. I don't know why they didn't include all of the professors on one, but there is one difference here. Again, we have Buracek here. We have Murashko standing over him. We have Fejer Kruchevsky sitting. We have Heorhii Narbut above him. Then Vasil Kruchevsky. And we have Mikhailo Bujchuk. But then we have Mikhailo Zhuk, another. And Abram Manevich is missing. So I don't know why they did it, but there you have to see two pictures in order to see the full professorial staff of the Academy. And I will also mention four people who were absolutely instrumental in the creation of the Academy, which were the sort of academics. And especially the two on the left, Grigory Pavlo, on my left, on your right, no, also your left, Grigory Pavlutsky and Mykola Bilashivsky, people who are extremely instrumental in the formation of the Academy, and then their students, Dmytro Antonovich and Danilo Szczerbakiewski. Pawlutsky and Bilashevsky are not only instrumental in the creating of the Academy, they are instrumental in the creating of the Ukrainian art scholarship. It is their students who actually form the Ukrainian art scholarships, and Dmytro Antonovich and Danilo Szczerbakiewski are these students. Now, before I will get in a little bit more into the question of the Academy and the formation of the Academy, I want to give a little bit of a prehistory, why the formation of the Academy was so fundamentally important. By the way, the idea of the formation of the Academy was born exactly on the revolutionary day almost. It was in March 1917, which is the beginning of the Ukrainian Revolution. So this creation of that particular institution was key. And it did prove to be revolutionary in Ukrainian cultural history. And why was it so? Well, first and foremost, because it was the first Ukrainian art academy ever. It was the first institution of higher learning in arts in Ukraine ever. And this was not accidental, because over the centuries, attempts to establish such institutions in Kyiv were very consciously and very programmatically blocked by the imperial government. Myroslava mentioned the formation of the Imperial Academy of Arts, the importance of Dmytro Levitsky in it. I would actually go just still a little bit earlier. There was another Ukrainian, very, very fundamental in the formation of the Imperial Academy. Just as Kyrylo Rozumovsky, the last hetman of Ukraine, was absolutely fundamental and the first president of the Imperial Academy of Sciences, Antin Losenko was one of the founders and the rector of the Imperial Academy of Arts, a painter who brought the style of classicism into Eastern Europe, into Ukraine, into Russian Empire, a Cossack from Lukyu, by the way. So, but if Losenko, to his own detriment, stayed in St. Petersburg, he died very young. He was only 36 years old when he was, well, driven to a certain state of health in which he died. But his close friend, who left Lukyu together with him, they both went actually not to paint, not to study painting, but they went, as many, many Ukrainians of their generations and earlier and later, went to sing in the imperial choir, which was 95% Ukrainian, in both singers and conductors. But they both ended up to be major painters. But the friend, Ivan Sabluchok, as opposed to Losenko, who was, by the way, educated in Paris, and this is where he got his classicist style, Ivan Sabluchok decided, against all odds, to return to Ukraine and to establish a school in Ukraine. He went to Kharkiv and established what was called the additional classes of the Kharkiv Collegium, which taught painting. And very, very soon, according to art scholars, although we have very little actual artworks left from that, very soon this additional classes became a real competition to the Imperial Academy of Arts. It became de facto a Ukrainian Academy of Arts. And once it happened, they were immediately, by an imperial decree, closed and never to be opened again. Another attempt to establish an art school was in the mid-19th century in Kyiv, which was constantly blocked by the imperial government. And finally, at the end of the 19th century, a private school was allowed to be opened. It was the Kyiv Drawing School by Mykola Murashko, which became extremely important for Ukraine because it educated most of the Ukrainian painters of the time. Later, Kyiv Art School was created, also a private school, which also an extremely important school. Well, think about the people who were taught there. Alexander Arhipenko, briefly Kazimir Malevich, Alexandra Ekster, Alexander Bohomazov, all of these future stars of the Ukrainian painting came out of that school. However, the school itself was far from being good or ideal. Actually, as a school, it was following the tradition of the Imperial Academy of Arts in St. Petersburg, which was extremely, extremely conservative, which was conservative to that degree that most of the Ukrainian art students refused to go to St. Petersburg to study. Their closest place was Krakow in Poland, where they would go, but ideal, of course, it would be Munich or Paris. And most of the people that I will show you took that route. And the one who didn't, you will see the results in his paint, in his painting. The Imperial Academy of Arts in the through most of the 19th century was promoting a very stifled style of academism based on a pseudo-classical sort of, and it started with a very important painter, Karl Brülow, but then it was basically led to constant imitation and total lack of artistic freedom. Later, the Peredvizhniki, who were mentioned also by Myroslava, were rebelling against the academism. Eventually, they were accepted. They became part of the academy, and they became the extreme conservative element in the academy. And by the 1917, Imperial Academy of Art was to a large extent Peredvizhnik-based, a style from which, in the future, socialist realism would develop. So, why I'm saying this? In 1917, when Ukrainian Academy, State Academy of Arts is being created, there are two revolutionary things that happen with it immediately. Well, first, just a little bit more of prehistory. The first idea in March of 1917 is to reform the Kyiv Art School. At that time, Fedor Krichevsky, the guy in the middle, is the head of the Kyiv Art School. He makes weak attempts to introduce some reforms, but when he finds a strong opposition, he resigns. By the summer of 1917, it becomes clear to everybody that it will not work with the Kyiv Art School, that something completely new has to be established. And almost immediately throughout the summer, the whole program is being created, and the fact that it has been delayed until November is only the question of the bureaucrats of the Central Rada, who can never deal with all of the things that they have to deal with, and they just postpone and postpone and postpone. Actually, even on the 22nd of November, they are not ready yet. They have not recognized officially the academy. They officially recognize it only on the 5th of December. And then only on the 22nd of December, they approve the state funding for the academy. And within a month, the Bolsheviks attack, and the situation completely changes. So the bureaucrats, as usual, are working against the culture and making sort of everything go slower. But, so what happens in the 1917 in the establishment? Two revolutionary events. The Ukrainian State Academy of Art, in its official documents, is an academy which is based on the tradition of specifically Ukrainian art. This is totally for the first time, and actually unlike the second institution that I will describe to you, which is the Kyiv Conservatory. And if we think about the tradition of Ukrainian art, and I think many diaspora people and many people in Ukraine would immediately imagine some Cossacks or some Easter eggs, or something, the folky kitsch that many people associate with the national sort of folk tradition. As you will see from paintings, suggest that it's nothing of the sort. The Ukrainian art tradition, as understood by the founders, is completely different. And if you realize how conservative the Imperial Academy was, actually, even the Paris Academy was pretty conservative at that time. If I will show you now the first exhibition, I mean the examples of the first exhibition that also Miroslava was showing you, actual pictures of the walls with paintings of Narbut on it. And you will see what kind of art, Ukrainian art, they are trying to establish, and what kind of approach to art in 1917 they're trying to establish. And as far as the academies go, it is pretty forward-looking. It is quite modern and quite... So, let's go on. Let's see the first actor, Alexander Murashko. Why is he first? By the way, not exactly a, not entirely a relation to Mykola Murasko, who had the first drawing school. I mean, an illegitimate son of his brother eventually got the name, initially for a long time called Sashko Kroczkowski. But he is a, he was educated first in the St. Petersburg Academy of Art. His professor was Ilya Repin. And he went along that first Peredvizhniki movement, but very, very strongly, very, very quickly rebelled against it completely. He went to Munich, he went to Paris, he became very famous for his paintings of Parisian cafes and so on. And in the end, he developed a type of style that is sort of in a mixture of impressionism and realism. And in this, he considered himself very deeply rooted in Ukrainian art, by the way. He was the person who rebelled against the Keio Art School and established his own private studio in order to show how students can be taught art freely. And as you will see, this is sort of an impressionistic play of light on a realist. Now, this is one of the few things in which he uses Ukrainian sort of national folk elements, one of the very rare. But even these paintings are sort of not exactly folky, if you would. And in the academy, he was teaching genre painting. So this was the thing that he was trying to introduce. Vasil Krichevsky, and Renaissance man with very, very little formal education. He was an architect. He was making kilims. He was making pottery. He was making everything possible, and especially based on the very deep, and he was a great connoisseur and great knower of the Ukrainian traditional art. However, in painting, when you go into his painting, you don't see that at all. He is much more towards impressionism. But this is his very famous architectural creation, the Poltava Zemstvo, whom today Poltava's museum. And it's both the architecture and the ornamentation. He was a master ornamentation. Now, Heorhii Narbut, I will just skip very quickly because you have heard about him. The only thing that I will say about him, that he was the Academy of Arts in 1919, when the Academy was in his home, and he was responsible for basically everything about it. When, as you will hear a little bit, or maybe I'll not have time to tell you, all of these people had very fascinating stories, very many of them tragic. Mikhailo Bujchuk, a painter, one of the greatest Ukrainian painters of the 20th century, and born in Western Ukraine, educated in Krakow, Munich, in Paris specifically. In Paris, he established his first school. He became famous already there. And by the way, he was recognized by Guillaume Apollinaire, of all people, and who created a name for his style, Renovation de l'art byzantine, which is not very correct in Ukraine. He was simply called Bojchukism. And he was a master of fresco, of a composite painting of that were combining Ukrainian folk tradition, especially icon tradition, the Byzantine art, and the 14th century Quattrocento Italian Renaissance painting into very, very modernist type of art. So, then Mykola Buraczek, impressionist par excellence, a master landscape painter. He was called, he loved the sun, and he was called the master of the color of the and the light and the sun, from Podila, educated in Krakow. Fejer Krzyczewski, the first rector of the academy. However, not exactly by the popular choice. The first rector was the first elected rector was his brother, Vasil Krichevsky, who refused to be a rector. The second rector was Alexander Murashko, who also refused. Mikolajczyk refused. Fedor Krzyzewski was the choice. Why I'm sort of a little skeptical about him. He's the only guy who really got educated in St. Petersburg. And he's the guy where it shows. See, he takes the Ukrainian art, folk art, and makes it almost into a kitschy from the very beginning. I'm sorry if I mean, many people like him, but I don't. He basically copies Ilya Repin's Vechornetsi into something that would seem a little bit modernist, but really is not. And not by any accident, he becomes the first one who embraces socialist realism among all of the... None of the other ones actually embraced socialist realism at all. Mikhailo Boychuk in the 1930s tried with all of his mind to create socialist realist frescoes, but he couldn't. This guy found it quite natural to switch. He had a very, very tragic life at the end. He was basically killed by the Soviets. So in any case, this is not in any way. Then Abram Manevich, one of the interesting stories. A Jew from a Jewish ghetto in Mstislav in Belarus, who moved to Kyiv, could not stay there officially because it was outside of the pale of settlement. He was saved by Mykola Bieliszewski, the guy that I showed you earlier, who basically made a painter out of him. And out of this great gratitude, Abram Manevich absolutely identified himself with Ukrainian art. He ended up living not far from here in Bronx. For much of the 20 years, last years of his life. Still, according to his closest friends were Ukrainian, especially his closest friend was David Burluk, but he, till the end of his life, was wearing the embroidered shirt that he brought from Ukraine. And when he died in 1942, he made her daughter promise that she will get 50 of his painting donated to the Museum of Ukrainian Art in Kyiv, so that he remains part of Ukrainian art. It took her 30 years, but she did it. They are now he is a master post-impressionist painter. As you see, this is, excuse me, he died 1942 in Bronx, yes. Yes. And the best paintings that he did were actually between 1917 and 1921, when he already left Ukraine, 1921. And Mikhailo Zhuk, also educated in Krakow. He is a symbolist to a large extent and a master ornamentalist. And as you will see, this also, it has Ukrainian elements, but it does not have any kitschy side to it. It's completely reformed, rethought. Since I don't have much time, I could tell you stories about all of these guys in very much detail. Actually, some of them are on my TV shows, Oczyma Kultury. You can look at them and get the fuller stories. But what I wanted to tell you is just one final remark about this, about the Academy. What you see here is really some of the, probably the best examples of Ukrainian artists in their given fields, with one exception. There are no avant-gardists. There is no Alexandra Ekster, who was there in Kyiv, very, very in the center of art world. There is no Alexander Bohomazov, who is the same. Malevich at the time is in Moscow, but they do come back, because this is not the end of the Academy. I will, by the way, I will tell you that in 1921, they already had 530 students. They started with 143, and by in a Kyiv ravaged with famine and with constant warfare, this is how successful they became. In 1924, they were restructured by the Soviet government into the Kyiv Institute of Arts. However, they were restructured from within, basically keeping most of the people who were inside. In the meantime, Lev Kramarenko joined, and all of these people who became later the most important part of the 1920s Kyiv Art Institute. And they did accept the avant-gardists. They took Bohomazov, they took Viktor Palmov. Eventually, in 1928, Malevich comes back to Ukraine and becomes part of the institute. And although it was decimated in the 1930s, still it became and still remains today the most important art educational system in Ukraine. Because I don't have time, I'll switch immediately to music and prepare the ground for the next presentation. Kyiv Conservatory, it was established in a different way and in a different time. It was established a little earlier, 1913. It was established not as a Ukrainian musical institution, but as a musical institution, as a conservatory, as a part of the imperial music system. They did not accept anybody from the Lysenko school. They took the general musicians. However, this was the original building, doesn't exist anymore, near Hreshchatyk, of the conservatory. However, it was the revolution 1917-18-19 that created a massive switch, massive transition in it. And actually, this conservatory became the beginning of the new Ukrainian music and still continued throughout the 20th century, continues to be today. It was established in 1913 because of the impact of some very well-known composers with very strong Ukrainian ties, like Peter Tchaikovsky, half Ukrainian, who was very closely connected with Ukraine and was insisting on creating, like Sergei Rachmaninoff, who was not Ukrainian but who had a very strong Ukrainian sentiment, and they were the two, and the first two rectors of the academy, of the conservatory, actually set the music, so to speak, for the future. One, maybe you don't know him today, it's Volodymyr Puchalski. Not a very well-known person, but a phenomenal pianist of his time, and him and his close friend, a little bit later in the 1920s, created the Ukrainian piano school of the 20th century. Puchalski's student, most famous student, Vladimir Horowitz, probably you don't have any question knowing who that is. You don't have any problem knowing who that is. And then there is another pianist who comes with Puchalski a little later. His name is Grigory Beklemishev, a man who was probably the founder of the Ukrainian piano school in general. Sviatoslav Richter is his direct student. But I will give you one example of what he did in 1924-25. You can imagine that the people did not have record players, they did not have MP3s or whatever. They could not listen to music unless it was played live. And if you are in Paris, in Vienna, in St. Petersburg even, you can hear all sorts of music. But in Kyiv, in any provincial town, you cannot really. So Grigory Beklemishev took upon himself to give free concerts for everybody who wants to hear of 2,500 works on the piano, starting from the very early Baroque music to the most cutting edge at the time, Paul Hindemith, Webern, Schoenberg, and so on. It was 1 year, but this is how Kyiv became educated in music. We don't think about such elements, how it takes. Then the second one is Reynold Glier. He's a Frenchman born in Kyiv, so Kievan of French origin, who became a prominent, quote-unquote, Russian composer although his connection to Ukraine is extremely strong, and he is, was very, very much aware of his connection in Ukraine. His, in 1917, 1918, there was a tremendous impact on this man by another person that we mentioned yesterday, but who should be discussed maybe in more detail, Les Kurbas. Reinhold Blier was created music to some of Kurbas' plays, and most significantly, Haidamake. But what he was also for Ukrainian music, he was a teacher and a mentor of arguably the most important 20th century Ukrainian composer, Boris Latoshinsky. And it is 1918 that Boris Latoshinsky, a very, very, very young man, composes his first symphony. And this is the first real symphony in Ukrainian music. I mean, there was Bortnyansky, there was Berezovsky, with very nice classical symphonies, but I'm talking about symphonies of the post-Beethoven style. Or with all due respect to Mykola Lysenko, who tried to write symphonic music, but failed in most cases, and the creator of Ukraine's anthem, you all know. Mikhailo Verbitsky, who wrote a lot of symphonic music but never finished any symphony. And actually, the beginning of the 20th century where symphonies were actually written, when Kalachevsky wrote his very melodic Ukrainian symphony, when Petro Sokalsky wrote his symphony. But this is only the first symphony of Lyatoshinsky really became the world-class symphony of a very, very, very young guy. I mean, a genius, obviously, musical genius. Next to him is Lev Korevutsky, who created the style of neo-folklorism in Ukrainian music, who then was a teacher together with Latoshinsky. Latoshinsky and Revutsky taught the whole generation of the 1960s, Silvestrov and so on and so on. And then, last but not least, Kozitsky and Verikiewski. And they are actually, on their music shows something very special. They actually started to write a new church music for Ukraine. After Stetsenko and after Leontovich, this was a completely new language in music. It is something that brought in world music into Ukrainian church music as well. I will end on this, and thank you very much.
And we'll speak now on Kyrylo Stetsenko, another Ukrainian genius, a prolific composer, conductor, critic, and teacher. Late in his life, as you know, he became a Ukrainian Orthodox priest and head of the musical department of the Ministry of Education in the short-lived Ukrainian People's Republic. The speaker is Melanie Turgeon, who is Associate Professor of Music and Choral Director of the King's University in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. She has conducted numerous choirs and ensembles and has presented research at several academic institutions and conferences in Canada and internationally. She has toured extensively with her choirs, including two very successful European tours. Highlights of Dr. Turgeon's research endeavors include the publication of a book entitled Composing the Sacred in Soviet and Post-Soviet Russia, and the hymnal with an accompanying 5-CD set, Sing to Our God, and it was published in 2008. The full biography is available, so without further ado, I give the floor to Melania Turgeon.
So I'd like to speak today about some important things regarding Kyrylo Stetsenko and most importantly the Ukrainian Art Song Project. things that I'd like to cover today are just determining what is an art song, what is the Ukrainian Art Song Project. I know that many of you have exposure to it already, which is wonderful. And maybe some of you here today have never heard of it. And it's a wonderful initiative that I wish to expose you to today. We'll cover which Ukrainian composers contributed to the art song genre, and also particularly talk about Stetsenko as a composer, a teacher, a conductor, how he participated in the art song, and also how he was a part of the Ukrainian National Republic. Stetsenko's life was definitely impacted by the upheaval and unrest in Ukraine in the early 20th century, and this definitely had a bearing on what he wrote, particularly his art songs. What is an art song? It's important for us to know some of the basic characteristics, and it'll be such a pleasure for you to actually make allow this to come to life this evening in a wonderful concert. So I'm really excited for you to hear this. There's a beautiful relationship with an art song between a pianist and a singer. And I wouldn't even consider the pianist an accompanist. I would consider them an artistic collaborator. And often you'll hear the term collaborative accompanist because they are both equally important. They both share very strongly in bringing the poetry and the music together. And art songs would use occasionally an additional instrument like a cello or a flute. Today, unfortunately, you won't hear that because just two singers will be joining us this evening and a pianist. Once it becomes a little bit fuller in terms of instrumentation, then already we're starting to bridge toward a genre called vocal chamber music. So often our Ukrainian composers did include, for example, a cello or a violin or a flute, but usually not more than a piano plus those complementary instruments. The text is usually written by very highly regarded poets, and it has a high literary quality. Unlike a folk song, an art song is intended to be performed at a recital or another or other formal concert settings. One thing that I think is wonderful is in today's day and age, we see a variety of performances of art songs where we'll see, you know, possibly 1,000 people attend an art song concert or 200 or 300, but their original intention was for it to be a very intimate form of kind of performance and communication. If we look back to kind of the initial art song composers, the Germans such as Schubert, these were done in people's homes. And it was a wonderful way of sharing kind of art, high art, so they called it. Literary salons is what they would often term the locations of where these concerts would take place. And I'm excited for you because you will be an intimate audience this evening with these wonderful musicians. So you won't be worried about competing with 900 other people to get a wonderful view of what's going on. It'll be essentially a meeting of academics, just like it originally was intended by the German initial art song composers. Texts are in obviously a variety of languages depending on what country it hails from, and obviously those countries have given it different names. So you've heard the word Lieder applied to it by the Germans, you've heard Melodie by the French composers, and for Ukrainians, most often the term is solospiev that you've that is used mostly with the Ukrainian Art Song Project. The Ukrainian art song genre became definitely well established by Franz Schubert in the 19th century. For example, one of his most popular works, The Erl King or Der Erlkönig in 1815, which sets the poetry of Goethe. And normally, it's the poetry of very highly acclaimed national poets. So for the Germans, it's people like Heine, Goethe, Shevchenko is very important for us, Alexander Oles, Lesha Ukrainka, and you'll see the names of many others as we continue forward. And these were poets who had a significant reputation in what they did. The art song genre continued to be popular in Germany, as well as in various European countries, France, Russia, Bohemia, Poland. And later on, we also started to see art songs in Ukraine. However, there were two things that most definitely impacted its birth in Ukraine. There was a decree issued in 1876 by Tsar Alexander II of Russia banning the use of the Ukrainian language in print, performance, and in scores. So essentially, Ukrainian composers were forced to break the law in order to write an art song. And did they do it? Absolutely, they did it. Despite these sanctions that were imposed, Ukrainian composers still persevered, and they secretly wrote art songs, and I love this phrase, for the drawer. So they would write them, they would hide them, and now many of these art songs are coming into the right hands, and they are finally being published, which is such a wonderful thing. The second impacting factor on the art song within Ukraine is definitely the Bolshevik Revolution. And this Soviet society did not support the development of the Ukrainian art song. They did not like the fact that it was a Western tradition imported to the East. And they termed it, used terms such as formalist or aristocratic or bourgeoisie or intellectual. They obviously preferred and encouraged folk music and propaganda music, sung most often by semi-professional musicians. And despite these conditions, Ukrainian poets still persevered, and they still wrote poems, and Ukrainian composers got those poems, and we have wonderful art songs to be very proud of. Without a doubt, Mykola Lysenko is the first Ukrainian composer to write art songs, and only in the 1950s did we start to see some publications that had art songs within them. However, these publications were not exactly performance friendly. They were more so academic publications. And it was in 2004 that the Ukrainian Art Song Project was founded. And without a doubt, the main driving force behind this initiative, is the famous bass baritone Pavlo Hunka. So I know that some of you have met Pavlo before, and Pavlo has a wonderful way of encouraging people to support this cause. And I really respect him for the wonderful initiative that he has to bring all of this music to the main world stage. He's proud of it, and he wants to expose it on the world stage, the classical music stage. Pavlo has started his career as a lawyer. He's born to a Ukrainian father and an English mother, and he studied modern languages initially, and practiced law before going on to vocal studies. And he started his career in Switzerland. And Pavlo is definitely a very busy opera singer. Yesterday, I received an email from him. He's in Berlin right now. He's under the baton of Simon Rattle and singing there for the next little while. He's got an extensive biography, and it's wonderful that he's kind of taken this project under his wing, and he devotes a lot of the summers to coming to Toronto and making it come to fruition there. Despite the fact that we consider Lysenko the first main art song composer, the Ukrainian Art Song Project began with Stetsenko, the works of Stetsenko. And I think that there's a very practical reason behind that. Lysenko wrote 124 art songs. Stetsenko wrote 42. They were just starting this project, and I think Lysenko scared them a little bit in terms of the volume of music that was there to get recorded and published and performed. So they started with Stetsenko, and at first, you'll see in this photograph, it was these musicians that were involved in it initially. You see Pavlo Hunka on the far right there next to him in the white sweaters is Benjamin Butterfield, the tenor, and then Russell Braun with the vest on. And One of a few of Stetsenko's art songs use cello. So you have Roman Boris from the Griffin Trio, who was working that day and recording that day. Albert Krywalt, who you'll hear this evening, is the pianist who will be with us. And Roman Hurko, who's the producer. Now, all of the recording is done up to this date at the Glenn Gould Studio in Toronto, a wonderful place to record. And much has changed since 2006 when this was initially done. Several more musicians are involved, and they definitely brought in some female singers, which is wonderful for the next series of CDs, which is Lysenko's art songs. Now, at this time, I'd like to concentrate specifically on Stetsenko. So he was born in central Ukraine. He was the eighth child in a family of 11 children. And he was definitely raised in a religious family. His father, who's pictured in the bottom left, was an iconographer. I thought I had pressed it hard enough. My apologies. So you'll see on this slide, his father is on the bottom left there with his mother. His father was an iconographer, and his maternal grandfather was an Orthodox priest. On the right, you'll see Kyrylo, the young boy, with one of his sisters, Natalia. We can definitely consider Stetsenko a child prodigy. He was merely 10 years old when his uncle, that would be his maternal uncle, took him to Kyiv, where he was enrolled in St. Sophia Church School. He attended that school for 5 years, and he lived with his uncle throughout this time, only returning home to his parents for the summers. There's no doubt that the Kyrylo's family struggled financially. When he returned home, he would work to earn enough money to purchase some clothing. So within 3 years of attending St. Sophia, Kyrylo became the choir conductor at the age of 13, and he also wrote his first composition, which was a choral composition. After his time at St. Sophia's School in 1897, he entered the Kyiv Theological Academy and Seminary. He attended the seminary from 1897 until 1903, and during this time he composed several of his works for choir. And there you see him at that time, the young man. There's no doubt that Lysenko and Stetsenko had a wonderful relationship, a relationship of mentorship, and a teacher. Lysenko was Stetsenko's teacher. So while he was in the seminary, Stetsenko became acquainted with Lysenko. He was his student, and as well as a singer and the assistant conductor in his choir. Lysenko mentored Stetsenko and introduced him to several significant poets and musicians. And there's a wonderful quote of Lysenko commenting that this will be the person to replace me after my death. So obviously, the teacher had a fair amount of confidence in his student. Lysenko and Stetsenko started what one would call a national movement or national style of composition. Particularly, Lysenko was the person who encouraged ethnomusicological endeavors. He wanted his students and colleagues to make use of folk songs, to work with them and be inspired by them, to appreciate their beauty, not only as part of the past, but also as vital, though fragile, elements of a contemporary tradition. Lysenko, Leontovich, Koshitz, and Stetsenko definitely contributed to a national movement in Ukrainian composition, which involved the creative use of folk materials. These individuals caused the emergence of a new school of national music. They tried to do for Ukraine what they witnessed in other national composers like Smetana and Dvorak. And just an anecdote, just the week before this conference, in Edmonton, we did a concert of all Ukrainian choral music with an orchestra there called Orchestra Borealis. So a wonderful opportunity to expose our Ukrainian music to mostly non-Ukrainians. And I found this comment by one of my students quite interesting. The concert opened with the overture to Lysenko's opera Taras Bulba. And she said to me, she goes, you know, Melanie, if I didn't have the name of the composer, if you wouldn't have told me whose music this was, I would have absolutely thought it was Dvorak because of it being littered with all these wonderful folk melodies. They come into play and then they disappear again and then they come back. And so there was definitely that movement of kind of a national style in it. And it went on for quite some time, and it was picked up, you know, later by other composers, and a very important kind of initiative to go into the villages and collect this material. So what really is this national style of composition, and what does it involve? As I mentioned, you would collect folk song material, and you would use these folk materials as sources for arrangements. You would often quote folk songs. You would utilize dance rhythms. And you would base entire works often on folk customs or rituals, composing melodies that are very broad and patriotic. This style also boasts beautiful lyrical melodies and rich harmonies. When the music has text, it was the high frequency was to utilize Ukrainian poets and librettists. Now, Stetsenko's life was deeply impacted by the upheaval and unrest in Ukraine in the early 20th century. He desired to establish an independent music publishing house. However, for a variety of reasons, this did not come to fruition. In 1907, his actions led him to be arrested and exiled out of Kyiv to a town in the Donbass. There he taught music from 1907 to 1910. When the Russian Revolution of 1917 began, Stetsenko returned to Kyiv. In 1911, he surrendered to the pressures of his uncle, and he was ordained a Ukrainian Orthodox priest. And it is difficult to know if he truly felt called to join the priesthood, or if this decision was somewhat influenced by a desire to experience financial security. And I say that because of a quote that I've included here. "Financial security, however, came at a price. The composer was required to serve in an obscure village in southwestern Ukraine, far from the cultural life of Kyiv. There, in his self-imposed exile, Stetsenko weathered the political storm of World War I. When the Russian Revolution began in 1917, he returned to Kyiv, and it was at this time that the Ukrainian National Republic was founded, and Stetsenko became the head of the music section of the Ministry of Education. Together with Koshitz, Alexander Koshitz, he formed the Ukrainian Republican Capella. Stetsenko led one group of singers that toured Ukraine to promote national unity, while the choir led by Koshitz toured beyond Ukraine to propagate Ukrainian music and culture. 1920 was an important year for a variety of reasons. The new communist government disbanded the choirs, unfortunately, when the Bolsheviks took over. Koshitz, however, then reorganized the Ukrainian Republican Capella into the Ukrainian National Choir in 1920 in Warsaw. Thereafter, their touring of Europe and the Americas resumed, and they continued their mission of promoting the Ukrainian National Republic. By the time the group disbanded in 1924, they had performed approximately 900 concerts. That's just unbelievable to me. Also in 1920, Stetsenko was forced out of Kyiv yet again, and he continued his priestly ministry in the village of Veprik. We have some photos of these choirs that were formed. At the top there, you have the Ukrainian Republican Capella while they were touring Czechoslovakia in 1919. And then in the bottom right-hand corner, the Ukrainian National Choir, that with their new name, in Belgium in March of 1921. This next slide is very interesting. Pictured here is an audience of over 32,000 people at a Ukrainian National Choir concert in Mexico City on December 26, 1922. Now, I don't know about you, but if I get 320 people at one of my concerts, I'm pretty thrilled with that. I can't even imagine what that would be like. And I think there's more people at this concert than there were at Trump's inauguration. It looks very full to me. That's quite phenomenal, so. Fake news, you bet. The village of Veprik. In 1921, Stetsenko co-founded the Ukrainian Autocephalous Orthodox Church. He also founded a theater and a choir in this village, which is a wonderful initiative. And while ministering to the sick in this village, unfortunately, Stetsenko contracted typhus, and he died at the age of 39 in the spring of 1922. I can't imagine how much more music there could have been if he would have continued that earthly journey, because he left us with a lot in those 39 years. In 1982, the home in which he lived became a memorial museum, and this is also the home, apparently, in which he passed away. So what did Stetsenko leave us with? What was his compositional output like? He composed music for various genres, including, as mentioned, 42 art songs, a large variety of choral works, music for several stage works, including plays, children's operas, and two additional incomplete operas. His two most prolific genres are the art song and choral music. He wrote well over 100 choral works, including two divine liturgies upon the Hida, both accompanied in a cappella choruses, cantatas, and several folk song arrangements. Stetsenko wrote some of his most significant works merely months before his passing. This included the panegyrica dedicated to the memory of his teacher and mentor, Mykola Lysenko. I happened to see that score, and I taught one of my choirs that panegyrica for a Holodomor commemorative event, and it's absolutely gorgeous. So I don't think there's many recordings out there of it, so I think that that's going to be one of our, I think, future recording projects. So beautiful, beautiful work. In terms of his art song output, I included a wonderful quote by Pavlo Hunka from some of our email correspondence recently, and he said, "Stetsenko was my first choice to record, as he is an accessible to all composer, very melodic, equal in piano and voice, extremely expressive, and he chose very clear and direct texts. Stetsenko almost exclusively utilized the poetry of Ukrainians. Poets such as Oleksandr Oles, Taras Shevchenko, Lesha Ukrainka, and Boris Khnichenko, and others that we'll see in a list later on. The themes of Stetsenko's art song, some general themes, we have a lot of social and political injustice, nature, love, which is often unfulfilled love, suffering or exile, despair, various folk themes, and particularly the theme of hope and resilience during hardship. The title of my presentation is the title of Stetsenko's final art song. Porvalisya struny, broken harp strings. This song was composed during the Ukrainian Civil War of 1920. The spirit is undaunted, but the harp strings are broken. Nevertheless, both poet and composer press onward with hope. Probably this was his last art song, and that's such a continuous theme in his art songs, that there's a lot of suffering, there's a lot of kind of unfulfilled sentiment, but yet there's always a wonderful glimpse of hope in the poetry, and you'll be exposed to that this evening, and you'll be able to follow along. Also, if you know any of Stetsenko's art songs, it might be Vechernya Pisnya, probably his most popular one, and we'll end tonight's concert with that beautiful gem. It was the signature sign-off tune for the broadcasting day for the Ukraine State Radio. So back to the Ukrainian Art Song Project. What has been done so far? So they started in 2004, and what have they managed to accomplish in those several years? They have published all of Stetsenko's art songs, 42 of them. They've published and recorded all of Mykola Lysenko's art songs, 6 CDs worth. They have also published and recorded Yakiv Stepovey's art song, 55 of them. And then they made a Taras Shevchenko poetry, kind of a compilation, single CD to commemorate that anniversary. And then just a couple years ago, they released Galicians 1, 81 art songs recorded in 2011, but released a few years thereafter, and it includes those following composers, Sechinsky, Yudkevich, Barvinsky, and Stefania Turkevich. female composer. That's a big deal. So, wonderful modern composer, Stefania Turkevich. You'll hear at least one of her pieces this evening. And she is a composer who studied with Arnold Schoenberg. So some of her music is atonal. So it's quite advanced for this time in Ukraine. And she also wrote a divine liturgy. It's not entirely complete, but I have performed several movements from it for a choral conference last year in Edmonton. And it's very ambitious, very interesting to hear, kind of pushes you a little bit and makes you question, is this music intended for church worship or are we bridging towards concert music? But we definitely did it within a church service. Galatians 2 is the recording that they are currently working on. Most of the recording has been complete two summers ago, and you'll see on the screen there the composers that it includes. Pictured here is Stetsenko and Stepovey. So two young men who are important contributors to this genre. And I really like Stepovey's hat. That's why I included it as well. So. One thing that is very interesting with this Ukrainian art song project is that Pavlo Hunka is the only Ukrainian singer. So all the other names here that you see on this list, maybe you recognize some of them. These are very prominent Canadian opera stars. So he's selected some very important people for this journey with him. He wants it to be done very well. And he also has that ambition that these are the people who will expose this music for us. Because they're prominent performers, they have students that they teach, and this is a good way of continuing to allow this music to get into not only the Ukrainian streams, but also a larger community as well. So this evening you will hear Monica Witcher, soprano, and Andrea Ludwig, mezzo-soprano, and the pianist will be Albert Krywald. Here's some of the instrumentalists who have been involved, several pianists as you can see, and then as we mentioned, there's the odd time where there's an additional accompanying instrument. And you'll notice even that these are also very prominent performers. In the bottom left corner, that's Roman Boris from the Griffin Trio and a very important cellist here in Canada. And then we have Russell Braun on the right there. I wanted to give you a sense of, up until the end of the Lysenko set, kind of who are the poets that are involved. So the ones who had more than 10 songs are in white so that you can kind of draw your attention to. And there's one that definitely sticks out, and that's the German name Heinrich Heine. And what Lysenko did was he had an entire a song cycle translated into Ukrainian, and he set the music for that. And that was a pretty kind of gutsy move at the time when the Ukrainian language was forbidden in print and on stage. And he got someone to translate Heine's poetry into Ukrainian, and he set an entire song cycle, which is featured on the Lysenko CDs. I'll just quickly comment towards the end here. What else is part of this initiative? So the Ukrainian Art Song Project, first of all, obviously collects these art songs that have been kind of hidden and lost. So if you have any in your attic, you know who to give them to. And then they record them. So the next stage is recording. The stage two is the desire to have all this music accessible and available in the public domain. So they want anybody anywhere in the world to be able to download it free of charge and to be able to transpose it into any key. Some wonderful features because of a program called Sibelius Scorch. So they're definitely approaching it with a very thorough and a modern way of making it accessible to a large population, a large community. At this present time, the scores are not available on the website, but it's just kind of a momentary glitch and it'll be up running again very soon, I'm told. But should you need anything, simply contact myself or Pavlo, and Pavlo is always so quick to respond and to share whatever music you need. I had a young student say, I wanted to perform this piece on my recital, but I can't find it on the website. And within a day, Pavlo sent him far more material than he ever desired. Stage three is performing and promoting this music. So this involves visiting various faculties or schools of music, music conservatories, in order to expose students to this vast amount of vocal repertoire that exists. So Pavlo has definitely traveled to various universities, festivals, conferences. I've had him at the university that I teach at in Edmonton. And this spring, Benjamin Butterfield is coming to our King's University to give a masterclass and concert of Ukrainian art songs. And then this summer, we're having our first Ukrainian Art Song Summer Institute in Toronto. So it's a wonderful way for us to involve several young students and immerse them in this culture of art song. If you can believe, the goal, eventual goal, is to record approximately 2,000 art songs by the year 2025. So 352 have been recorded so far. Pavlo thinks that he has approximately 1,161 in his possession. And I love this quote by Pavlo. I guess that there will be approximately 2,000 by the end if we live that long. And you can see the list of composers up and coming. The list is massive. I just included approximately 10, 12 names for you to just browse through. So there's even talk now of possibly moving the project to Ukraine for the summers. It might be a little bit cheaper to do the recording there, and apparently they do have some wonderful equipment. So there's some definite talk of different possibilities to make this move along, maybe even at a faster rate in the future. So I thank you very much for your attention, and I really look forward to hosting the concert this evening and for you to experience some of these wonderful pieces of music. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Wonderful three talks. I have a question to Myroslava, but maybe others can also respond. I'm curious about the question about the nationality of painters. It's, for example, a question that I'm very interested in, mm-hmm. reference to Heorhii. So Narbut, wonderful career in the center of the empire. Russians, I think, speak of him almost exclusively as a Russian painter. What kind of principles, factors enter into your framing him as a Ukrainian painter? Not that I suspect it, I totally agree, but I'm interested in the kind of the intellectual framework that informs you as you present him as a Ukrainian painter. And that would, of course, include, you know, other writers of painters of this time, Malevich, for example, or Burluk. You know, are these guys Ukrainian? And if so, how and why?
You touch upon a very complex issue, which incidentally has come alive recently in discussion after witnessing an exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art. It's Revolutionary Impulse, the Russian Avant-Garde, with a number of Ukrainian artists blatantly included in the Russian Avant-Garde. And the question that raises is convention. You know, I've witnessed prior to the dissolution of the Soviet Union where museums would see the Russian Empire as a Russian identity. So Kyiv was part of the Russian Empire, the artist is Russian, right? So that's convention. In a post-Soviet period, when most people in the world now realize that there are other countries that had comprised this imperial sphere. There are museums, for example, who would seek to identify the origin by birth, to identify the artist. So that's one way of identifying. There's another way of identifying, which I think has to do with self-identification, how an individual sees himself or herself, what part of culture, what kind of culture do they see drawing from and contributing to. And so there are some people like Ekster, for example, may be of Russian ethnicity, but ethnicity doesn't matter here because she was such a central part of the developing of the Ukrainian avant-garde. We had a discussion about Kazimir Malevich, who we know has Polish lineage. So what do you do with an artist who is Polish, Ukrainian, Russian? And I think in the case of someone like Malevich, it's really self-identifying with the culture at particular moments in his developing career. So that he very clearly identifies in his autobiography with his childhood in Ukraine, drawing on the color, the customs, the habits, the peasantry, the values even. And this becomes central to his further development, even I maintain through his most abstract moment, which is suprematism. There is something about orthodoxy as he experienced it in his youth in the villages and the devoutness of the villagers in Ukraine. And then he comes back and teaches at the institute. So we can call that a Kievan period, but I think we can also call it a period of self-identifying with his compatriots, as it were, because he had many friends. So this is kind of a roundabout way of trying to address the issue. I don't think there's a clear-cut manner to say, born in Kyiv, therefore Ukrainian. Not everybody born in Kyiv would be Ukrainian. But I think one has to go beyond simply place of birth, and one has to take into account, if you're looking at a creative person, that body of creative output. And once you look at the body of creative output, you are really recognizing that personality, that persona. And you know, once you recognize that persona, you realize that his identification is connected to, predominantly, let's say, to a particular culture, which then you can name. But, you know.
If I may add to it a little bit. Yeah. I think that with Narbut we have a very easy time because he not only identifies himself, he's not only born in Ukraine, he not only comes back and he includes all of these Ukrainian elements in it and in the end says that he hates Muscovy. So it's easy, but it's really a very, very complex question with the painters, with musicians, with sometimes with writers, but primarily with these. I would add one more thing to this, not only as a self-identification of a painter, but also, well, the body of his work. What his, and as an example, I tried in one of my TV segments on Mykola Ge, a painter who is considered to be Russian by even Soviet encyclopedias, who was born in Ukraine, who was of partially French, partially Ukrainian origin, no drop of Russian blood in him, who spent most of his time in St. Petersburg, but he still eventually returned to Ukraine. He was one of the central figures of the quote-unquote Peredvizhniki movement because he never was a Peredvizhnik. He never actually got in. But what I'm trying to say is that in his art, he's so clearly not Russian that you cannot put him into that. He is basically a pre-expressionist, which is a style completely foreign to that time in Russia. But actually, you can find elements of it in Ukraine. And he is, although he never identifies himself, his brother identifies himself. His brother becomes, a Ukrainophile and gets sent to Siberia for it. Mykola Ge never says it, but his paintings say it, in my view.
Besides, you do remember that Kazimir Malevich used to say, "I am a Ukrainian and I am proud of it." He liked Ukrainian songs. He liked Ukrainian music. He returned to Ukraine at the end of his life. The next question, Professor Grabowicz, please.
Viktor Ostapchuk, I have a question for Myroslava Mudrak and Marko Stech. In regards to Narbut, well, first, quick question. Was he born in the village of Narbutyuka?
Narbutyuka.
Yes. And it was named after him, or he was named after
that? No, that was his ancestral
home, right?
Home, yes.
Now, you implied or said in the beginning, it's a historical question, that he was inspired by what he saw in Narbutyuka or Hluchy in that area in his first phase of his life in Ukraine. And you showed us also some printed books, Street Bible and so forth. How do you know that it was at that time, or when chronologically, when did he really find these roots, these inspirations that you pointed out? And so Marco, a question is, you contended that there was no, it was a deliberate imperial policy that there was no imperial academy, art academy. I mean, it's striking because you had an opera in half a century earlier, just about in Kyiv. And to demonstrate this, it'd be interesting to look at other provincial cities and whether they had, in the Russian Empire, whether they had such schools. And it's interesting to what degree that can be demonstrated. Thank you.
Okay, quickly. Marco just showed us that we have 3 minutes. So, very quickly, there's a lot of literature on Narbut. At the time of his death, there were exhibitions, so all this material was amassed, so that we have a lot of printed scholarly material, I would say, regarding Narbut. So in some of these, in the catalogs or in, you know, descriptions of Narbut or biographies of Narbut, we find out about his impishness, you know, back in Narbutyuka, where they sent him to the Hluchiv school to, you know, train him a bit. And it's at the Hluchiv school where, distracted by other things rather than the learning that was part of the curriculum, that's what he would do. He would draw, he would copy. And so that is the beginning of it all. Now, I showed the Ostrich, but you know, these are just examples. I just wanted to give you examples of the style of those manuscripts. I'm not saying that he had access directly to that. I think it would be important, of course, to find out, you know, what collection would be there for him to be able to look at that.
Okay, thank you. Professor Grabowicz, please.
It's all right. It's all right.
Mike.
I'll get up so you can see me. All three papers were very interesting. Since we are sort of at loss for time, I'd like to pose this to Myroslava Mudrak. I was very struck by the way you juxtaposed Narbut's being part of the Mir Iskustva and at the same time being as totally committed to Ukrainian art and its implicit separateness from that. And before I put the question, I would like to comment. I think that, you know, this is a central issue because frequently the innovation or the revolutionary breakthrough is precisely not only in contrast to the hegemonic structure, but into a redefinition of the of one's own. So in literature, a precursor of Narbut could be seen as Kotlarevsky, who is, you know, revolutionizing Ukrainian poetry by introducing the Russian verse meter. You know, Ukrainian poetry was syllabotonic at that time, or syllabic, and he is introducing syllabotonic for iambic meter and so on. And and moving to the future, it is Tichina, who is a contemporary of Narbut, but is fated to live, you know, to 1967, and continually innovating and changing the very notion of what poetry, especially Ukrainian poetry, is, of which he's very conscious. So, for example, he writes a letter to Zerov saying, my contemporaries want me to continually write Sonyashni Klarnete, you know, and he's already moving into Pluch and Zamisuneti Oktau, and then finally Shabla Kotovsko in 1938. Mm-hmm. So the short question is, was Narbut aware of this? Was he actually formally thematizing the question of reforming? I think you were implying it, but did he write about it? Did he thematize this issue?
No, he didn't. He didn't write about it. This is my reading of it. And I think that, looking at his body of work and following it chronologically, it becomes stronger and stronger and stronger as time passes. And I I called him a Janus-like figure because I do feel it's as if there are two faces to him, looking back and looking forward, but pulling everything that he learned from his from the period before the revolution and inserting it into a context that was native and very familiar, and I believe that he truly, truly loved. And so it gained a new life. It was a revitalization of, let's say, the formalism, the collectivity, the strictness of delivery in his manner that then became a language that identified. That's why I called it branding, because I think when we look at Narbut, we think Ukrainian things.
Well, we were very late, so we have to move on to our panel.
Thank you very much.
At 2:30.
Thank you for your time.
2:30.
Thank you to the speaker.